starting to get cold up here in the Northwest, and as the temperature starts to plummet, that can mean only one thing. It's perfect recording weather. So we've been tracking bass guitar all week here in the studio, and that's a great opportunity to show you several different ways to get a killer bottom end bass tone. Guys, it's Steve from Featherlight Studio, and we're in studio tracking bass all this week, and I thought it would be a great opportunity to run over a couple of different methods of recording bass. And we got some great vintage cabs to work with today, so I'm going to show you several different methods that you can get huge bass tone with, and how getting that tone may not always involve manipulating the frequencies that you think it does. First, it goes without saying, if you're tracking bass guitar, do yourself a favor and change your strings. Nothing sounds better than a brand new set of strings, and preferably put them on the night before and give them a chance to acclimate on the body of the bass and the room you're tracking in. If you're doing pop or rock or a wide variety of different kinds of genres, the Ernie Ball regular slinky line for bass covers a ton of ground. They've got a lot of different gauges to choose from, everything from normal to drop tuning. The bigger the number gauge, the deeper the tone, and they're a great balance between affordability and performance. If your string's longevity is the primary concern, then you're going to want to check out DR's Black Beauties or the Elixir string line. These actually add a coating to the string itself and can extend the life of your strings by twice as much. And the choice between using round wound and flat wound strings is really going to be up to your own individual playing style and the genre of music that you're working in. For most genres of music, strings that have a blend of nickel and steel in them are a great balance of performance versus cost, but if you're doing metal, especially new metal, you're going to want to use stainless steel strings. Check out strings like DR's High Beams and Low Rider series, or Dean Markley's Blue Steel, or D'Addario's Pro Steels if you're looking for a string that'll produce tons of aggressive in-your-face bass tone and growl. And if you're doing drop tuning, check out DR's drop-down tuning line of strings. These maintain the correct string tension even at much lower tunings. If you match the bass tone for the genre that you're working in and you get this right, getting that killer bass tone later at the mix stage will be so much easier. And the next most important thing is listen to the sound of your bass acoustically in the room. Does it have any odd buzzes or noises you need to deal with, either from the pickups or the knobs or the selector switches? Do you have any fret buzz? These all play a huge part in the sound of your bass that you're going to be tracking. Then plug it in and listen for those same noises, especially in the pots and the selector switches. If you have rattle and buzz problems now, it's going to get a lot louder once you amplify it. There are as many ways to record great bass tone as there are opinions about it, and a lot of the modern day bass heads give you lots of direct out options, including pre and post configurations that allow you to capture the sound of the head directly to your audio interface. And while not everybody has access to these tools, it's still possible to get monster bass tone running directly into your audio interface. If your only option to record your bass is direct through your interface, it's important that you engage the high Z switch option, either on your mixer or on your audio interface. This is especially true for bass guitar, as it makes sure the impedance is correct before you begin recording, and that relates directly to your tone. If you got a few bucks lying around but you can't afford to spring for one of the more expensive bass heads, you might want to think about picking up a better quality direct box, as this is one of the best ways to ensure that all the power and fidelity and punch of your instrument gets recorded correctly into your audio interface. Good quality DI box will give you more than just complete control over things like hum and ground issues and mismatching levels, but some have access to more advanced features like the ability to reamp and to adjust for the passive and active pickups of your bass. Now that our bass is set up and it's ready to record, we've got new strings in the genre and our style, it's time to track some bass in the first of our methods, and that's straight into the interface. Rather, it's out the back of your amp's DI function, or out of a great DI box, or straight into your audio interface using the high Z switch. It's time to record some bass tracks and actually do something with them that'll give us some monster tone. So we've recorded our bass tracks out of our DI box into our audio interface, and they're tight and punchy. They sound great. And from here, we could simply go up to our inserts tab and we could choose Steinberg's VST bass amp. This is an incredible bass emulation VST. There's a wealth of amplifier and cabinet combinations to choose from, as well as presets. There's a ton of them to choose from. They're all really good, and we would have a really good bass tone. VST bass amp is a powerful plugin with a lot of configuration options between the amplifier combinations and the cabinet combinations, as well as microphone choices and pre and post effects and different configuration options. Plugins are a great solution for quickly building a bass tone. So we could simply slap a number of plugins on here and we could call it good. Our bass tone would be finished, but we want more control over the bass tone itself. We want to be able to divide the bass tone up the same way that higher end pedals do, which takes the incoming bass signal and puts it to a crossover network, which splits the signal into two or more bands, allowing each one to be affected independently. And then when you add dirt and crunch and all the other stuff to the high band, it doesn't affect the fundamental of the bass band. That's super important if you want that bass to remain punchy and powerful sounding, but you want to add dirt and grit and all that other stuff, and you don't want to sacrifice your low-end bass tone for it. So we're going to go up to our bass direct track that was recorded here, and the first thing we're going to do is duplicate the track itself. So now we have two identical copies of our bass performance here. And then we're going to create an additional track. We're going to come up here, and this track, instead of being mono like our original recording, is actually going to be stereo instead. And we're going to explain why here in a second. We're going to call this bass direct top. And then before we do anything else, and this is super important, we're going to group select everything in our duplicated track here. We're going to hold down the command key to click and drag, or the Windows key on a PC style keyboard. If we click and drag while holding the command key, this will keep the clip from shifting to the left or the right. And we're going to drag it down to our bass direct top track instead, which is now a stereo track. We're going to take that and our other track of our original performance, and we're going to put those two in a folder. We'll go ahead and retitle the folder bass direct. And in addition, we're going to enable the folder's group editing button here. Now, whatever we do to one track will happen to the other track. If we drag either track to the left or the right, it's going to drag the entire group here. This is super important because these tracks cannot get out of phase with one another, not even by a few samples one direction or another. If we click that one, it's going to select the one above it as well for that particular clip or take. Any editing that we do here is going to affect all of them simultaneously. This keeps them in phase with one another, and it keeps them sample accurately locked. Super important because if they get out, even by a couple of samples, one way or the other, we start to introduce phase problems and all of our bass fundamental goes right out the window. So the first thing we're going to do with our bass direct is we're going to rename this bass direct bottom. So we have bass direct bottom that's a mono track, and we have bass direct top that's a stereo track. That's really important. So from here, the first thing we're going to do is come up to our inserts tab and we're going to add an EQ. We're going to choose Steinberg's frequency. This is a great sounding musical EQ that can be both dynamic and linear. So the first thing we're going to do is take our top frequency. We're going to create a high shelf and we're going to drag this all the way down to about 200. And this is going to create a low pass filter at around 200 with a very gradual slope. This is really important if we choose a really extreme slope like this and we try to marry these two tones back together again, it's going to create a ton of phase problems because of the sharpness of this. So we want this to be a nice gradual shelf. We're going to get out of there. We're going to come to our bass direct top and do exactly the same thing there. Again, we're going to choose Steinberg's frequency EQ and we're going to do the opposite of it. So we're going to create a low shelf, which is going to create a high pass filter, and we're going to do the same thing. We're going to drag it up to about 200. And the same thing applies here. This is basically going to split our bass tone into two completely independent bands with nice gradual shelves so that when we marry the two tones back together again, they're nice and clean and phase free. We're going to start with our bottom channel and we're going to add a compressor to it just because the level obviously is really low since we're only dealing with incredibly low fundamentals. We're going to use this to bring the gain up just a hair and to control some of that bottom end dynamic. All right, so now that our bottom end track fundamental is safe and sound and tight and punchy, we're going to go ahead and mute that and move on to our top track. And instead of adding a compressor here, we're going to add something different. could just crank the volume of the channel, but instead we want to actually work on the tone itself and change it dramatically. And we could probably do this with quite a few different kinds of plugins. But instead we're going to choose Steinberg's Quadrafuzz. And this is a great plugin for adding dirt and grit. It can be run as a single band plugin, or it can be run as multi-band. This has four bands. The lowest band here we're not going to use much of because we've already split our bass tone into two completely independent bands to begin with. So we're really just going to be using the top three bands. And as you can hear, it's already adding a lot of grit and growl to it. We can change the overall mix of the total plug and the outputs of it. And we can mute and solo and bypass each one of the bands so we can get a clear idea of what each one's doing. We're going to start on the second band, and we've got several different kinds of distortion we can choose. We're going to keep it on amp setting at the moment. This is where we're going to get a great deal of our growl. And we're going to use the third band on distortion mode to really bring out the pick sound of the attack of each one of the notes. And because this is a stereo track, we can change the position of just that pick sound. By changing the panning position of just band 3, which is basically just the pick attack noise, we can add some subtle positioning to the bass and give it a sense of space without affecting the growl of it at all, which is band 2, and none of the fundamental, which is our lower bass track altogether. Once these two bass tracks are sent to our bass group, we now have complete control over the high and low character of the bass guitar. One of the other ways to get really massive bass tone and more realism in your overall sound is to mic a cabinet if you have one available. In this next example, we're still going to go out our direct box, but we're going to use the link or through output to go into our cabinet as well. And this way we're going to get both our direct sound and we're going to get a cabinet sound. We're going to put two different microphones on the cabinet. One's going to be a 57 on top since this is a 212, and we're going to put a Beta 52 on the bottom with a much larger diaphragm so we can compare the difference between the two tones. Each microphone has its own strengths, and being able to combine that with the direct sound gives us an amazing amount of control and puts us well on our way to designing our own custom monster bass tone. And in our final example, we're going to be miking two completely independent bass rigs all together. We're still capturing our bass's direct sound through our DI box, but we're going to take its additional output and we're going to split it. One side's going to go to our acoustic amp with the custom cabinet, and the other side is going to go to a vintage Fender Bassman rig. And this thing is just great for tons of vintage grout and dirt, and it sounds awesome and makes a great companion to the acoustic head and custom cabinet on the backside. And because these are actual cabs in a real room bouncing around, we get a lot more organic texture and vibe than we would if we were just using the first method and doing it all in software, so we don't need to manipulate stuff quite as much to get that same tone and feel and ambience. So there's a quick look at several different methods that you can use to track huge bass tone and also control that bass tone after the fact inside your mixes. Hey, if you learned something or if this was helpful in any way, please hit the subscription and notification bells. It really does help keep the channel going. Thanks for hanging out with me today. Be safe, be creative, add something creative to the world. They could really use it. Take care. We'll catch you guys in the next video.